There are certain birds that actually eat oysters. They're called oyster catchers. But the birds feed in and around them because there's all kinds of tiny little crabs, juvenile crabs, and crustaceans that live down there in amongst those oysters. And birds can walk around and pick them out. When the tide rises, the redfish, a very popular sport fish, they cruise those oyster beds right there, and they're trying to eat those little tiny crabs and the crustaceans in there also.
So nothing eats the oysters as a whole?
When they're young, well, oyster catcher, the bird does. And when they're young, other fish, black drum, can actually crunch those shells up and eat them. But when they're this big, other than people, not much else eat them. Raccoons can pry them open and eat them. Now, up in front of us, the little green building we're looking at is actually a research laboratory. We call it a field station. It's not permanently staffed. It's operated by the University of Florida. Look at that osprey on top of the post there. University of Florida leases the lighthouse itself and 4 acres of land right here. They maintain this research facility, so they often bring student groups out here on field trips and occasionally longer term research projects. Marine science, of course, biology, zoology, and so forth. They will occasionally spend the night. When they spend the night, the lighthouse serves as their dormitory. The ground floor of that lighthouse, if we haven't been able to get a very good look at, has bunk beds, kitchen, generator, running water from a well. It'll accommodate about 25 students overnight. It's the lighthouse itself and the lab are open to the public 2 times a year. One Saturday in July, that varies from year to year, which Saturday that will be, you have to check ahead of time. But it's always open, third weekend of October, which coincides with our annual seafood festival. That's a big event in Cedar Key, a lot of people in town, in fact crowds of people. Of course, that's coming up this weekend. Now during this open house, there'll be staff out here from the University of Florida and from the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, Rangers Fish and Wildlife Service, to greet you and answer questions and show you around. Those days, I don't do a regular tour. I just bring you straight out here and turn you over to them. I'll let you spend an hour or so on the island. We'll come back and pick you up.
So what kind of little bird house is that up there?
That's a martin house. I don't think they used that yet this past spring. It's only been there for a year or so, but maybe they'll pick up. There used to be one there that was an exact replica of that lighthouse. Mm. One of the hurricanes back in 05 or 04 or 05 blew it down. So somebody last year, somebody put this one up there, but I don't think they've started using it yet.
The holes don't look like they're accessible.
So that doesn't look anything like the lighthouse itself?
Not really. Now the lighthouse, it's a very unusual, very different lighthouse. The tower that we can see out there is made of cast iron and it sits right on top of a one-story building. The building itself, the main structure underneath the tower, is built with tabby. You know, there was no need to build this lighthouse on the long, slender column like most of the lighthouses you see because of the natural elevation of this island compared with the surrounding area. And the, of course, when this was in service, all those trees were always cut down. Fresh seafood, all the different nonprofit groups in town, the Eagles, the Lions, a lot of the school clubs, the senior class, the cheerleaders, the Marine Science Club, the Methodist Church, everybody has a booth down there where they sell some kind of seafood in the park.
Is it start on Friday or is it end of Saturday and Sunday?
Saturday, Sunday. That's an osprey nest. Osprey like to nest out in the open, so these platforms were put here many years ago to encourage osprey nesting. Although they don't really need all that much encouragement or help now. They're plentiful here. They're like pigeons in Central Park here. There's probably 15 osprey nests on this island. Most of them are in the trees. But we do have about 20 active bald eagle nests around the refuge. But when the tides low like this, I can't get near any of them. But they're a very common sight around here as well. Bald eagles.
Oh, I swear you should have seen that, how that fish jumped.
We've seen absolutely no effects of the oil. And there's a number of different government agencies that have been coming in and out of here, taking fish samples, water samples. So far, there have been no effects, one way or the other, from that oil.
Well, it's going to come in.
Never came any closer than about 90 or 100 miles. This is the closest it was ever recorded to being here. The only thing that affected was our tourism. A lot of people were afraid to come here. They were afraid that maybe it would show up, you know, once they got here. So it went down a little bit. And we don't have all that much of it to start with. And the other thing was our fish industry, our clams, oysters, and well, we weren't oystering that time of the year anyway. That was close season. But our clams and our crabs, the sales went down a little bit. People in general were afraid to buy cold seafood. I think most of that's over with now.
But well, the price of oysters went up in the restaurants. At home, and you know, out of the
free to do so. Now, last thing, next to the last thing, we want to point out our fire extinguishers. Here, there's one over there on the side, right behind that door you came in on. There's another one on the side of the helm over there. Last thing, in the blue and white cooler, plenty of bottled water in there. If you get thirsty during a trip, just holler a bottle, let us know. We'll get you one out, or if you have to be up at the time, feel free to help yourself. Any questions? I had a question just a few minutes ago. I want to go ahead and get it out of the way. I might forget to cover it later on. And while it's fresh on your minds, some of y'all were looking at a kind of a prehistoric creature up there along the shore called a horseshoe crab. A little known creature. been around for a long, long time. Like I said, it looks prehistoric, but extremely significant to the ecosystem, to migratory birds, and to medicine these days. That very unlikely creature right there, as it crawls up in these beach areas like this, especially in the spring, but also in the fall, it burrows in and lays eggs. Many of y'all, most of y'all perhaps, have seen the small birds running up and down Florida beaches, chasing the waves back and forth. That's one of the primary foods that they feed on, especially in the springtime. Most of those little guys you see running around the Florida beaches, they're different kinds of pipers and plovers, nest on the Arctic tundra. They have a 2,000-mile flight to make to get back to the Arctic tundra to nest. Those eggs provided by the horseshoe crab provide a very rich and high-protein diet to help them make that 2,000-mile flight, and also to be in healthy enough condition to breed once they get there. Now, even more significant perhaps, some of the new revelations concerning this creature, its blood. It's copper-based, it's bright blue in color, it secretes a particular enzyme that is currently being used to test for the presence of bacteria. Almost all batches of pharmaceuticals that come out of major pharmaceutical companies, medical instruments before surgery and so forth, are tested with this chemical that's made from the enzyme of the blood of the horseshoe crab. It will detect the presence of bacteria within 30 minutes. Now, formerly, to confirm the presence of bacteria, you had to do a culture, 12 to 24 hours. Now, this doesn't tell you what the bacteria is, but it will tell you if bacteria is present within 30 minutes. Major breakthrough. The skin of that horseshoe crab is used to make sutures, the type of sutures that can be left inside the body. They will dissolve inside the body. In addition, the skin of the horseshoe crab is used to make a burn dressing. It can cover large burn areas. It looks like a large sheet of saran wrap. It can be placed over a large burn area to keep it sterile, protected, and it never has to be pulled off. It goes right into the skin. So there. That's what you were looking at over there.
How much skin is on the side? Like the top part of the shell. How much skin underneath?
I suspect that they extract from a number of them and make it and mix it together into some kind of a compound or a blend to make these sheets of what looks like saran wrap. But the blood, when they take the blood from them, they only take a small sample and then they release the horseshoe crab. They don't have to kill the crab to take the blood samples. And that's a widely used ingredient these days. It's also used as a clotting factor in certain types of surgeries.
Yeah.
So there's a significance
of
that very...
Are they the same kind of horseshoe crabs that they have we have up north?
Exactly, on the beaches there. And if we want to show you and to tell you about, we want to start off with just a little bit about Cedar Key today. And then we're going to tell you a lot about our history here, most of which will probably surprise you if you're not familiar with it. And also about our ecosystem. We're going to move away from biology for just a minute. Cedar Key today, as you have found. How many of y'all have been here before? Several of you. Very unique little coastal community, unlike most any other coastal communities left in Florida. Population here today, about 900 people. We have a lot of hotels and shops and restaurants. They're very visible, and one might conclude from that that tourism would be our major industry here today, like it is in most of Florida's coastal communities. Well, it probably would be here also if it were not for the clam industry. You may have heard of that. We've become very known for it. Farm-raised clams. As an industry, it was introduced here about 16 years ago. Experimentally, technique had never been tried before. It very soon exceeded everyone's expectations. In a fairly short period of time, Cedar Key became the nation's largest producer of farm-raised clams. For some time now, producing in excess of $12 million per year. The clams, the oysters, marine life in general, absolutely thrive in this kind of murky, greenish-brown water. I realize it's not very appealing to look at. We like that crystal clear, sparkling blue-green water. I'll probably break down the marine ecosystem a little bit more later in the trip, but until I get back to that, or in case I don't, as we ride this morning, I just want you to realize that this water is in its natural condition. Nothing wrong with it. It looks exactly the way it's supposed to. Probably looked this way 1,000 years ago. it's consistent with the type of ecosystem we're in here, which is estuarine marine ecosystem. Once more, it's very clean water, free of pollution and bacteria. Very healthy, abundant marine ecosystem. More about that later. Let's go back to our harbor. Would you take the helmet on here, please? Let's go back into the later 1800s for just a little while. At that time, Cedar Key had a population of over 3,000 people. Remember, 900 a day, several thousand. Back in the late 1800s, Cedar Key was playing a very significant role in Florida's early settlement history at the time. It was also a busy sea port. What we call Dock Street here is where the old sailing vessels and steam-powered vessels would tie up to load and unload their cargoes. Very often, they'd be loading onto and off of railroad cars. Cedar Key was also the terminus, the beginning point, and the very first Cross Florida Railroad. That railroad ran from Fernandina over on the east coast, just below the Georgia line, diagonally across the state near the Cedar Key, came all the way out to the dock area. It was completed early in 1861. You may recognize that date. That was also the beginning of the Civil War. I'll tell you about our Civil War activity here later. It was after the end of the Civil War, 1865, that this railroad then became a major factor in that period of very sudden growth and prosperity that Cedar Key experienced for about the next 20 years. When that railroad was completed, it linked up the Gulf of Mexico and the Caribbean with the whole east coast of the United States. That rail line had been completed for many years. Designed and built by a man named David Levy. That's who Levy County here is named after. Okay, that was just a little introduction. Make some more stops going out to the islands. I'll fill in some of that time period between the time we were a town of several thousand and Cedar Key as we know it today. Have you generated any questions at this point?
Big pardon? You've heard that
Yeah, it's supposed to be a secret. It's that one right over there.
Special
buddy. On the steps right there.
On the steps, the
well, I'm just leaning a little.
Yeah. Oh, just off of Bill's house.
But actually, we donated that to her.
Which one, the pink one or the other one?
Now, the one on this side of the pink one. Out there in the water.
The air balloon. Okay. Well, it matches.
You can see her getting her combing her hair right there.
Any other questions? I'm not real up on what's going on with TV stars.
How far is the railroad going?
Okay, pardon?
How far did you say that? The railroad went?
It came from Bernadine to Cedar Key. It came all the way out to the dock area. It took a little different route coming across the marsh than Highway 24 does. But it ended up right out here on the dock area. Yeah, right below the Georgia line. I mean, just below. I mean, you can see Georgia.
I've taken the ferry from Jacksonville.
Yeah, that's where Cumberland Island is. Right there below the Georgia line. And see that rail from Georgia all the way up to the coast, New York, New England? They've been running back and forth for years. So this rail line from there to here, turning even to here, linked up the Gulf. A lot of the Caribbean, more effectively with the East Coast in general, played a major role in the period of growth and prosperity we had during that period. Only for about 20 years, though. I want to know what happened after that. Any other questions before we speed up just a little bit?
Those stacks that you see in the distance, that's the Crystal River Power Plant?
Excellent question, and that's the correct answer.
Okay.
Very shrouded in haze out there on the left. Barely see some structures out there. They appear to be in the water. Now, people have often asked me, newcomers to Cedar people often ask me, why does the sun rise in the west in Cedar Key? Becky, that to be the Gulf out there in front of. See, the Gulf is off to our right. So if we look back toward that power plant, that's Crystal River. Those structures are right there on the coastline. We're looking east, southeast. We're looking that direction. And from here to there is 23 miles across the water. Remember, we're on an island out here.
Cedar Key is an island.
You can run off a nuclear or coal. We have coal barges, coal trains.
Well, I didn't know that.
You can run one side or the other side.
Where's this power plant he's talking about?
Straight out of the horizon, right? Straight out. I can't even see.
Under the cloud bank.
Look at the tip of the island. See the tip of this island? Just to the left at the tip of the island.
Oh, I see it.
Yeah, it's hard to see. I mean, every time I look back up, I have to find it again. It's hard to see.
Because when you say cloud, I'm looking at the predominant one. I see what you're saying now. And that's Crystal River.
Yes, ma'am.
What are these? Are they windmills out there? What are they?
Those are channel markers.
Oh.
It lets you know where the deeper water is. This coastline for many miles in both directions, really very shallow. Somewhere. This is probably half the kids here on the beach and the other half are on the boat, and they'll come back and trade them. So they they look like they're kind of playing and kind of doing stuff.
They're learning.
But a lot of times they do seines out here. They pull a seine net and take marine samples to see what lives out there in the sand and along the beach.
Great way to get out of the classroom.
Absolutely. Now, this island is called the Etsina Oti, one of the outer islands to the Cedar Keys National Wildlife Refuge. So it is protected. No one lives here. Nobody lives on any of these outer islands. The others will come into view in just a minute. Cedar Keys Refuge is one of the older National Wildlife Refuges. It's over 80 years old. However, this island was only added to the refuge about 16 years ago. It's very often referred to as the original Cedar Key. One time, as many as 300 people lived here on this little tiny island. At that time, there were two different sawmills in operation. There was a church, a store, and probably about 75 houses. And keep in mind, it was an island community. There's never been a land bridge coming over here. There are very few remnants of that old settlement remaining on the island today.
When was that?
Well, it began, the growth began over here about 1860, somewhere around there, and it was all ended by 1896. I'll tell you about that in just a minute. Etsina Oti is a Native American name. Great deal of Native American history here, going back several thousand years. Several different cultures have come and gone, ending up with the well-known Seminole Indians. The name Etsina Oti translates to Cedar Island. At one time, this island, all the surrounding islands, and much of this coastline were covered in stands of virgin southern red cedar trees. You say the islands looked totally different back then. Now, all that was before a man named Eberhard Faber came to Cedar Key. You may recognize that name Faber. You've been seeing it on the pencils you've used all your life. He was the founder of the Faber Pencil Company. He came here in 1860 and built a sawmill on this island. Began to harvest the cedar trees to make pencils with. You're around Cedar Key much, you will hear people refer to this as the old pencil factory. Everybody calls it the old pencil factory. They really never made pencils here, though. Cut them into small slats, dry them, ship them to New York City. Faber had another facility where the process was completed. Not long after Faber established his mill, the Eagle Pencil Company also came to Cedar Key. They built the mill on what's now Cedar Key, and they too targeted the cedars, while other timber companies began to harvest the native longleaf pine, the cypress trees, and the live oak trees from the nearby mainland and the river swamp. They would float those in big rafts either up or down the coast here to Cedar Key, where that would be cut into lumber, shipped out to rail by rail or by sea. Now, while all this was going on, a major fishing industry developed. These waters are abundant with a variety of fish, sea turtles. Cedar Key is known for that. It's always been known for the sea turtles in this area. The number of sea turtles, stone crab, blue crab, oysters, and in that day, sponges was a big part of the industry as well. So based on this timber industry, the fishing industry, the railroad, and the shipping industry, Cedar Key grew rapidly and prospered through most of what is known as the Reconstruction Era. Times and conditions in general were very harsh throughout the South, but Cedar Key prospered during those years. People came here looking for opportunity. 1886, that population peaked out around 3,000 people. Unfortunately, by that time, they had cut down nearly every tree. No conservation whatsoever. Not only that, 1886 was the year Henry Plant completed the second cross-Florida railroad from Jacksonville to Tampa. That proved to be a more favored route, both for the railroad and as a port. Competition for Cedar Key. So, population not only leveled off about 1886, it started to decline slowly. Did so for about 10 years, and then in 1896, a catastrophic hurricane came through here and wiped it out. 130-mile-an-hour winds, 20-foot storm surge, totally destroyed all the sawmills. They had all been built right along the water. Totally destroyed the entire fishing fleet. Much of the town. Now faced with depleted resources, competition from a new railroad, there was very little incentive to even try to build Cedar Key back the way it had been before. So it was from that point, 1896, that Cedar Key began to be this little-known village. Little-known coastal village. Fishing industry eventually resumed, but never to the extent that it had before.
Is it that people are not allowed to live over there now, or just no one does?
It's protected. It's National Wildlife Refuge. Under contract with National Wildlife Refuge. Actually, this island is owned by the state, whereas all the others are owned by the federal government.
Wow.
Cormorants, brown pelicans, and the white birds are an assortment of terns. There's a couple of gulls up there. Almost all of them are royal terns, forested terns, and sandwich terns. And there's not nearly as many out there right now as there usually is. This is just a roosting place for them. Now, the general rule for all these islands, the beaches are open to the public for daytime recreation. We can land on the beaches to swim and picnic and fish, but in general, we're not to go into the interior beyond the vegetation line. This island's an exception. There's a walking trail there. Old settlement, there's an intriguing old cemetery on the back side of the island. Unfortunately, through the warmer months, from late spring through the next few weeks probably, as you walk into the trees at the end of that dock, you will be besieged by millions and millions of mosquitoes. You never know it out here in the open, but they are on the trail there. Now, as soon as it gets a little cooler, we begin to stop here on our regular tours. It lets you take about a 30-minute walk down the old trail. Little sandbar and oyster bar out there on the left, lots of birds there. Beyond, further on the left there, that's called Snake Key, Refuge Island. Straight ahead is Seahorse Key. Off to the right of Seahorse, one tiny island is Dead Man's Key. The big island to the right of that. Distance out there is North Key. The more immediate right, where the buildings are, that's called Piney Point. That's all part of Cedar Key. That's where our little airport is. Most of the water out here is very, very shallow. That's not true just here in this circle of islands. It's pretty much true of most of Gulf Coast from the Big Bend down the Crystal River. Very shallow coastline down to Tarpon Springs, actually. You have to go out about 20 miles to get 30 feet of water. Very shallow coastline. Seagrass beds. It's all part of the Florida Big Bend Seagrass Aquatic Reserve. 1 million acres of underwater seagrass down along the Big Bend area. All the way through here. It plays a major, major role. Ecological balance, and not only the coastal ecosystem, but the Gulf in general. Tremendous benefits provided by seagrass beds. Okay, any other questions before we head out to Seahorse Key? Yes, ma'am. They had barges, boats, ships, going back and forth all the time. Because by the time this island built up, beginning around 1860, what we now call Cedar Key, was called Way Key back then. It was filling up at the same time. There was a lot of boat traffic going back and forth. The shipping docks out there had already been established. They were running the ferry service back and forth. Never been any kind of a land bridge, so the railroad never came out to this island. Now, for many years, Cedar Key itself was strictly an island community. It was a lot of years. Matter of fact, it was about the time of the railroad that they even built bridges back to the mainland. Oh yeah, they got a lot of photos. They got all kinds. You can just, if you like that kind of stuff, the kind of stuff I'm talking about, you can get lost in there and stay there for hours reading it. They got old newspaper articles and photographs, books and pictures. Some days, I'm not sure what their schedule is.
We passed it coming in, it was
closed. Sometimes, you know, they got all volunteer staff, so they're not as open as much as they'd like to be. Barb, you know, would they open this afternoon, maybe?
I think.
Seems like they might be open this afternoon. I'm not sure. Their schedule varies a little bit because they are shorthanded. Okay, we're going to head out to Seahorse Key now. We'll be out there. It'll take about 10, 15 minutes to ride out there on a on an absolutely beautiful October day in Cedar Key. Seahorse gets its name because it's shaped a little bit like a seahorse. What is now an island, going back many thousands of years, was a very large sand dune. No trees on it. Big sand dune. Look at this school of fish right here on the right, swirling on top of the water. Look at all those fish jumping and swirling around in there. These waters are just absolutely full of fish and marine life in general. So at that time, this big sand dune was all part of the coastline. Once again, that's pretty much true of Florida's coastline all the way up. Thousands of years ago, it came much further out into what is now the Gulf than it does today. Now somewhere between 8 and 10,000 years ago, we think, the glaciers melted and receded. At that time, the sea levels rose, and at that time, this big sand dune was cut off from the rest of the coastline and became an island. At its highest point in the middle where the lighthouse stands, it is 52 feet above sea level, which is said to be the highest point of land on the entire Gulf Coast, all the way from Texas to Key West. Well, I'm going to go up just a little bit closer, but I can't get real close on this side because the water's going to get very shallow in just a minute. But in a minute, we're going to go around to the other side of the island where we will be able to get up much closer. The lighthouse was decommissioned way back in 1915. It's still used. I'll tell you about that in just a minute. It was originally built in 1854 by the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. This particular lighthouse has the distinction of having been built by then Lieutenant George Meade. He later became the very famous Civil War General George Meade, commanding general of the Union forces at the Battle of Gettysburg during the American Civil War. Before this lighthouse was built, in the late 1830s and early 1840s, those were Seminole Indian War days here in Florida. If you look over the side, you can see the grass down there. I told you we had seagrass beds out here. The water's less than 3 feet deep right here. You can see some of that grass down there.
Is that the light
yellowish
or beige?
Right.
That's the grass. Okay.
Late 1830s and early 1840s were Seminole Indian War days here in Florida. The Army had a major presence in and around Cedar Key at that time. They had a fort by the No. 4 Bridge, a supply depot, and a field hospital back there on at Sena Oti. On this island, an internment camp where they held captured Seminole Indians who were awaiting transport to reservations in the West. Later, during the American Civil War, this island served again as a POW site. However, it was operated by the Union Army. Very early in that war, Union forces came by sea, made a successful naval attack against Cedar Key, came here to destroy the salt works. Cedar Key had been producing large quantities of salt by boiling seawater in big vats. That, of course, was vital to the Confederate cause, used mainly as a meat and fish preservative. Also, to blockade the harbor. Also, to shut down this end of that newly completed railroad. The Confederacy made no real effort to defend Cedar Key, so they had accomplished their initial objectives pretty much in the initial siege of Cedar Key. They found that as long as they didn't try to go further inland, they pretty much had free run of the islands. Union forces occupied Cedar Key throughout most of the Civil War. On this island, they built a stockade where they held 35 to 40 Confederate prisoners. Right up to it. You know, we're on low tide right now. If the tide were higher, I'd have 6 feet of water. I could drive right on up there. Now, we're going to get a little closer on the other side. That's a little different view from over there. But we've got a little channel where we can get in a little closer over there. I wanted to show you that the island from the outside out here, show you the lighthouse from out here, and show you that big sand embankment. Mm-hmm. Give you a better idea of the formation of the island and the natural elevation of the island. Now, we're going to go back around to the inside, and I'll tell you what the lighthouse is used for today. Darker on the top and lighten up a little bit towards going down on the side.
Look at there, it's two of them.
These are bottlenose dolphins. nature by the little dolphin, the coastal dolphin. We find them up to normally within 10 miles offshore, right up to swimming in 2 feet of water. Jason Pollock right along the shoreline.
I got them. Excuse me.
We are said to have about 240 dolphins that live here in the vicinity. When I say the vicinity, that includes pretty much 10 miles up the coast, 10 miles down the coast, and 10 miles offshore. They're local year-round residents, so they're familiar with this boat. We see each other all the time.
And I'm snowbirds.
Sometimes they're very friendly towards the boat. Other times they don't really have any time for us. They give us a cold shoulder.
They do. I took a canal cruise, and the lady goes about, and she's not supposed to, but she sees sound.
Yeah.
And they know the sound of her motor. If you go with anybody else, you may see nothing. When you go with her, they start coming up. And one year I saw the mama duck. And 12 little babies in a line, right behind me. It's so, and the little raccoons coming up. It's just fantastic. The whales, how do they know your boat?
Oh yeah, these guys know me. I'm sure they do.
Well, they probably know you.
Oh,
what are you doing? I see you too. Oh look, there they go. They're going in the other. Oh look, there's still three of them.
These guys in the right mood, they will put on a show for you, and from time to time we've seen them do just about everything you've ever seen them do in a dolphin show. They'll jump out of the water, turn flips, swim on the tail walk. They'll catch fish and jump up, come up and throw fish back and forth to each other.
Oh,
it's getting a little frisky there. Jump. They'll jump way out of the water in synchronization as if they've been taught and trained to do it. But that all comes natural to them. He was only a few months old, three, 4 months old maybe.
There you go.
to the hole.
Every time you need to grab them.
Come on, Dolphy.
Yeah. We're definitely giving us a show. There he is. There's baby. So there'll be more right behind him.
Notice how that baby is sticking right close to mama. Almost touching.
Don't they always?
Can't say. I blame him.
When there's a boat around like this. He's really at an age, he's old enough to get out by himself a little bit, but since we're right here, they're sticking pretty close. You notice occasionally they'll bring their eye up above the water line and make eye contact with you.
Do you ever feed them or attract them?
No, it would be tempting, but number one, it's against the law.
Oh, okay.
Number two, it's bad to feed wild animals.
Yes.
Number three, most of the time you don't have to. Most of the time, they'll come over to the boat and give you a pretty good look at them without feeding. Time of the year, but most of them breed in the spring. Tremendous amount of breeding activity out here in the spring. You can see them doing it. They thrash around up on the surface. Very obvious. So most of them are born in the spring, but occasionally they'll be born a little bit later. Sometimes midsummer, sometimes midwinter.
Yeah, did you see that?
Look. That's pretty in blue.
Did you get the